Hello, everyone. Welcome. My name is Henry Blodgett. I'm the editor of Business Insider. This panel is being live streamed on Business Insider and elsewhere. Thank you so much for joining us. I'll set the scene for a couple of minutes and then introduce a remarkable panel. Could not be more perfect to talk about this issue. One of the themes of the conference this year is how to bring together a fractured world. One of the main reasons we are so fractured is that the benefits of capitalism are going to a very small segment of a lot of societies. Average individuals aren't seeing much benefit. So the question is, how do we fix that? How do we make it work for everybody? One thing that's clear, if you've come to a lot of the World Economic Forum conferences and you've watched politics for a decent period of time, is that government seems unable to fix a lot of the problems for a lot of different reasons, which means ultimately that companies have to do it. That's what I would argue. And that the way they need to do it is by creating value for many constituencies, not just shareholders, but customers, employees, and society. This is not a new idea, by the way. In the 1950s and 60s, at least in the United States, this was the stated purpose of companies. You were supposed to do that. It wasn't just about shareholders. But what happened was in the 1970s, we went through a period where there was a big economic malaise, company performance suffered, profits went down, shareholders did very badly for a very long period of time. And then in the early 1980s, we started to see the rise of activism, shareholder activism. And this was memorialized and really symbolized by the movie Wall Street, where the famous fictional corporate raider Gordon Gekko got up at a shareholder meeting and he told those executives at Teldar Paper who were saying, "How dare you tell us how to do our jobs?" Say, "Listen, look, you don't own the company, we own the company," and famously, "Greed is good." And one could argue that actually in those days, greed was good. Companies really needed to be reformed and kicked into shape and to start producing more value for shareholders instead of just executives. But arguably, the pendulum has now, after 30 years, swung way too far. And you can see this in the United States by looking at two measures. One is profits as a percent of the economy are near an all-time high. Wages as a percent of the economy are near an all-time low and have been declining for 40 years. And ardent shareholder capitalists will say, "Well, so what? Economics will just figure that out. It'll all work out." But the thing is that ultimately the problem for economies is that the money paid in wages to people who work is actually revenue for other companies. And one of the reasons the global economy and the US economy have been sluggish for so long is that the people who actually spend most of the money have not been paid enough to spend enough to drive growth. And so getting money in the hands of those folks will do it. And there are lots of reasons for this: globalism, technology, replacing jobs. But really, it's a choice. It's a philosophy about what companies stand for. So we at Business Insider have been arguing for better capitalism for many years. I would say several years ago, I was always greeted the reaction with, "Well, that's nice, but you're obviously a socialist because companies are about making money." And I would say very happily, this year, and especially at this conference, we are starting to see the beginnings of this acceptance by not only companies, but investors, that things may be starting to change and that companies can be serving a greater purpose than just that. And we see it with investors, we see it with voluntary wages increases in the United States, and most encouragingly, very recently, see it from a very major investor. Larry Fink of BlackRock wrote a letter, open letter to CEOs, which I'll read a little bit of segment of, saying, "Look, it's not just about money for us anymore." And to quote Larry, he said, "Society is demanding that companies serve a social purpose. Every company must not only deliver financial performance, but also show how it makes a positive contribution to society. Companies must benefit all of their stakeholders, including shareholders, employees, customers, and the communities in which they operate." That is better capitalism. And some of us are certainly rooting for that, to see that take hold. We have this wonderful panel. Let me introduce them very briefly and so we can go on to the discussion. On my immediate left, Teresa Whitmarsh is the chief executive of the Washington State Investment Board, handling over $100 billion. I complimented Teresa by saying, "Teresa, when you Google you, remarkably few embarrassing or colorful details come up. This is hard to do in this day and age." And say, "Well, I won't tell you the embarrassing stuff, but I will tell you that I live on a ranch and raise grass-fed beef." So interesting detail that is not yet on Google. Professor Joseph Stiglitz of Columbia University, one of the most accomplished economists of our time, many books, papers. It happens to be an expert in wages and inequality and many other things, and a Nobel Prize winner. Indra Nooyi, needs very little introduction, the chairman and CEO of Pepsi. Her stock price just hit an all-time high, which is sort of not the thing that one would include on this, but the irony of it, that we're talking about benefits beyond capitalism, seemed very good to mention that. Mark Weinberger is the CEO of EY, former assistant secretary of the Treasury, and says his stock price has also hit an all-time high. It's just private, so you can't look it up. And then lastly, Carlos Ghosn, legendary CEO of many companies, is now the CEO and chairman of Renault, formerly chairman also of Nissan and Mitsubishi, and recently on Bloomberg Television defended being a Davos man, something that a lot of lesser people would shrink away from. He did not. He said, I'm proud of that. So let us jump right into it. Teresa, let me start with you. You manage $100
billion.
$125 billion.
It's growing as her profits are growing.
Yeah. Is Larry Fink crazy? Is this something that you think about? Are you going to demand that companies you invest in serve something other than the bottom line?
Well, this has been an evolution in my own thinking over the last decade. And, you know, as an investor who I invest on behalf of teachers, firefighters, judges, childcare workers, I have a fiduciary duty to secure their retirement. And that in and of itself is mission driven, and it's a very high duty. So I struggled with this initially. And in fact, we have our fiduciary council come and give our new board members essentially lessons in fiduciary duty. And one of my board members came to me afterwards and she said, that was like a scared straight session. In other words, I can't think about anything now except fiduciary duty. But time horizon, it allows you to essentially reconcile fiduciary duty with stakeholder, shareholder, beyond shareholder concerns, societal concerns. Because if you think about a company that has a myopic focus on short-term earnings, they're typically sowing the seeds of their own destruction. And you see a lot of catastrophes that happen over time because companies are not thinking about how are they building for the long term. And as you're building for the long term as a company and you're creating value over time, you know, my returns are going to be better. So I think time horizon is what allows you to reconcile fiduciary duty with societal commitments.
So I want to get into the specifics of that, but I want to hear from everybody before we do it. Professor Stiglitz, is there one of the things that investors will say when you say, oh, but stakeholders, they say, oh, yes, but, and if I don't concentrate on anything but next quarter, I will be fired long before I can do anything about the employees and customers that you seem to care about. In economics and investment, the study of that, is there any evidence that caring about stakeholders helps or hurts returns?
Yeah, so first let me point out that you were giving a history of thought about this. And I want to emphasize that actually it was in this period, not only of activist shareholders, but Milton Friedman arguing that that was what was supposed to be economic theory said. And he was wrong. There was a body of economic theory that said that did not lead to an efficient economy. For some of the same reasons I think that all the panelists will talk about, you need a long-term vision, and if you're talking about the quarterly return, you're not getting that long-term efficient economy. We look at things, you know, being Americans, a little bit from an American-centric point of view, but for instance, Germany has had a long history of what they call stakeholder capitalism, and they've done very well. So we have countries that have had other models that have done as well or even better, and certainly for ordinary workers have done better. The final point I guess I make it is because of exactly the point that was just raised, if you are investing for the long term and you're investing for the retirement, you know, you're not focused on what's going to happen next quarter, you're concerned about the retirement income of your investor, that is going to be larger for the long term. I was a trustee of one of the American colleges that have, you know, a small one, but have a few billion dollars. And we took a very long-term view. And the result of that is we consistently beat the market. And when I asked our investment people, why do they do so much better than everybody else? And they said, we weren't chained to that short-run view. We could take the long-run view, and it really did deliver.
Indra, you have, I believe, 11 years ago started a performance with a purpose at PepsiCo. A long period where your stock, seemed to move up and down, but relatively sideways, which was good during the financial crisis and so forth, now has gone up. How do you think about that? That's a long time that you've been working on that. Now everything's worked out on the investment side, but how do you manage that and how do you balance the constituencies in the boardroom?
Well, let's start off by saying that when you start focusing on the long term and you really want to transform the company to where the company needs to go, investors are typically impatient and they're actually highly critical because they just don't see why the company should do that when the other companies in your industry are giving you a short-term return. So if you're doing something truly strategic and transformative, it always evokes criticism. So I always say that our stock price being at an all-time high, I have the results to show for long-term management and the scars to show for short-term management because they kept telling me, why are you Mother Teresa? Why are you trying to change your portfolio to healthier products? Because I thought that's where the market was going, that's where we needed to go. But it doesn't happen overnight. We have to make the investments, we have to make all the product portfolio changes to get there. And I think the biggest issue we have here is that we can talk all we want about short-term and long-term management. If we don't educate the investing community about asking the right questions of companies, we're always going to be pushing water uphill. Teresa, I'll be honest with you. In the United States, 90% of the companies we talk to, the buy side, never ask us a question and stick with a discussion of strategy. They want to know how's the quarter going to turn out? How's sometimes weekly sales? Why are your weekly sales this way? And how's the rest of the year going to turn out? If you go over to Europe, they ask you questions about the long term. And if you go to Asia, they ask you questions about the real long term. So I think we have to really think through, how do we want to think about duration? Is it quarter and 1 year? Is 1 year long term for the US and quarter short term? Is it 3 years, 5 years that's the appropriate long term? I don't know. We have to have that discussion.
Mark, love to hear your thoughts on, yeah, on whatever you said. Also, you are running a private company.
Yep.
Very large, very profitable, growing every year. Do you feel like you have an advantage, that you're shielded from this? How do you think about that?
No, because we're a partnership, and every year all of our partners want to see what their annual take-home pay is, and we've got to manage for the future partners as well as the local ones. So Andrew said it well. I mean, it's not only, though, the time period over what you report, it's what you report that people should be looking at. So, for example, for me, my business, we have 250,000 people. We don't make cars. We don't make food. Our value is in our asset is entirely our people. And median age is 29 years old. We hire 65,000 people a year. It is clearly training, developing those people for the long term. When I call around to my leaders around the world every year, I only ask them one thing. Their global people survey results. And how happy and engaged are our people? We now have data analytics that didn't exist years ago that will tell us if you have certain answers to questions with that data analytics, you will have higher quality and higher long-term returns in those business units. It's not the current financials that matter. The problem is when you look at when an investor looks at a company like Pepsi or any of us, what do they have but quarterly financial reporting, which doesn't even really reflect the value of the company anymore because most assets are now intangibles and brand and workforce, which aren't even on your balance sheet. There's no long-term way to compare companies or to measure with assurance whether they're doing a good job or not. So everyone falls back to the quarterly reporting. So one of the things that maybe we'll get into later that many of us, Indra and Teresa, are in a group we're looking at, how do we develop something that asset owners, managers, and corporates could all agree upon that could capture long-term value? And that when a CEO wants to think long-term, the investors will reward them for that, not punish them. We got to come up with that to get away from short-term quarterly focus.
And Carlos, let me sort of set the table for talking about long-term initiatives like self-driving cars and electric cars. Jeff Bezos, in one conversation that I had with him, interview, he said, look, one of the advantages that we have is we will take a 7-year time horizon with our big risky bets. And these are expensive. If they don't work, they're going to cost hundreds of millions of dollars. It's going to be very embarrassing. But our competitors, most companies, will try that for 1 to 2 years. Then the poor CEO will be browbeaten by the short-term shareholders you're talking about. They will give up because it looks bad in the early years. But we stick with it, and sometimes it works. In Amazon's case, sometimes it's a disaster, but they stick with it. 7 years, a long time. How do you, running a company, think about things like electric cars, long payback, self-driving cars? How do you do that?
Well, there are first, I totally agree on the fact that when you're talking about quarterly results, everybody understands what it is. When talking about long-term vision, everybody has a different interpretation. If you're in Japan, in China, or the United States, long-term doesn't have the same meaning. And on top of this, we talk about long-term plan or long-term vision. We should talk about long-term plans and long-term visions, because get ready to change. Get ready to change. My long-term plan 5 years ago is completely different from the one I have today, because in the meantime, I have a burst of artificial intelligence. I have a much more conscious regulator about emissions. I have Chinese government putting everything to incentivize electric cars. So you have to change, and you have to make sure that every year you explain the changes that you are bringing to your long-term vision, whatever it is. Now, it's not a level playing field. Let me explain to you. Young companies don't have to worry about quarterly results. We see it every day. Young companies, junior companies, new companies, they don't have to worry about it, because you can see the valorization of a lot of companies who frankly have pitiful quarterly results. I mean, we would come with the quarterly results negative, we would be crucified. So there is a difference, and it's a reality. That means age counts. I mean, the more senior the company it is, the more quarterly result is important. It doesn't mean that it's sufficient. You need first to deliver quarterly result to have the luxury to be able to be heard about your long-term vision. Because if not, you're going to be punished immediately, and then you know, there's going to be change in management and change of strategy. I give you two examples. Electric cars, Russian market. Two very simple examples. We launched electric cars in 2007. We were the only one. And I said we'd be dedicated 4 billion euro at that time to launch electric cars. But you have to consider that when you are putting 4 billion euro on electric cars, there are a lot of things you're not going to do. This is the difficulty. If you are open investments and you're going to do electric car plus, et cetera, it would be easy. But you have to make choices. I mean, if I put so much chips in electric cars, there are a lot of things I am not going to develop. And this is where the criticism comes. Is it smart? Are you betting the house, et cetera? And as you know, electric cars are taking off now. Now, nobody contests anymore that electric cars are going to be part of the industry. But for 7-8 years, you have to face a lot of criticism, skepticism. Your competition adds to it. So it's not something easy. The only way you can do that is to have a strong bottom line on quarterly results. If you don't have a strong quarterly results, you can't afford the luxury to have a long-term plan. Russia is the second example. As you know, the Russian market collapsed 4 years ago. I mean, for the car market, it went down 50% on a period of 3 years. A lot of car manufacturers left Russia. We doubled down. So all of a sudden, when you say, okay, Russia is not finished, this is the market of the future, I'm going to invest, I'm going to modernize, waiting for the recovery. Obviously, a lot of criticism. Why you're doing that? Are you sure? Et cetera, et cetera. So what saves us is the fact quarterly results are strong.
Now, Andrew, you said the same thing when we were discussing this a while ago. You can invest as long as whatever you're not investing in is throwing off so much cash that your earnings go up over time. Is that...
The portfolio has to work. Let me take the view of the fund manager for a second. They need to have a portfolio that's working. If every company they're investing in doesn't have short-term results and everything is priced to concept, it's way too risky. So I understand that legacy companies have a role to play in the portfolios, because we are tangible cash flow, we are tangible results they can hang their hat on. But the point is, if you put too much focus and too much pressure on companies that are actually laying the egg, we're never going to be feeding the goose going forward. And that's really the problem that we have. And in Russia, we doubled down in the downturn. I mean, we really doubled down and said, we love this market, it's got long-term potential, let's stay in there. But the rest of the portfolio worked brilliantly. So as long as we could balance every geography and product line, we could take the hit in Russia. But if we couldn't do that, we would have had enough critics to say, now's the time to get rid of it. Because for some reason, getting rid of businesses or countries seems to be a fashionable suggestion that some investors throw out to you, almost like it's a small cut that you can just, you know.
Because it will immediately raise the bottom line.
Yeah, it's just ridiculous, yeah.
So let me pick up on that and something that Carlos said, which is this idea that new companies get cut a break. And let me ask Professor Stiglitz and Teresa you the same thing. Is it that they're new? And let me give you a couple of specific examples. Amazon, famously, has never made money until quite recently, and then it almost seems to be an accident. They didn't find something they spent on. Stock price, $500 billion, one of the most successful companies ever. Netflix reported earnings last night. Yet again, negative cash flow into the hereafter. Kind of crappy operating results, and yet stock blast to a new high. Why is it? Is it age? Amazon's 25 years old. Why is it that some companies, folks, the poor folks on the end, have to deliver all this profit to you every quarter, and these Silicon Valley companies don't?
I think it's basically expectations. You know, there's not a revolution happening in automobiles, although electricity is a revolution. But until, you know, there is a conventional view that what's changing and in these main old legacy companies. But in the new areas, there's always hope. And no one really knows, and so it's all based on expectations. Now, as economists, we always ask the question, what are the barriers to entry? Because you can have a very good idea, but if everybody can imitate it, you'll get profits for a little while, and then they won't last very long. So one of the issues that you need to ask is there a significant barrier to entry that you can create, which may be against antitrust laws, so you shouldn't be doing this, but this is what we teach in the business school, and then in the public policy school, we try to tell the government how to stop the business school from doing what it's doing. But in terms of value, this is what you're doing. Are there barriers to entry that can't be easily overcome? And if there aren't, then even short-run profits, and certainly short-term losses, are not an indicator of future value. And that's why there's been some concern about some of these companies. Some of them are stretching, believe that there's a network platform externality, which is a natural barrier to entry. And that's what the market is betting on. Whether that's true in selling books is another thing. It may be true in delivery mechanisms for retail goods, including books.
Joe, just one thing, Joseph. Instead of saying all legacy companies, you might want to say earnings and cash flow generating, job creating companies. Just add that qualifier. Thank you.
And Teresa, do you have an explanation for this? Why is it that Amazon can make no money forever be worth what it is?
I think we need a behavioral finance economist here to tell us that. I don't get it. I mean, for us, because we are a really long horizon investor and we, you know, we're global and we have to be spread across all different asset types, sectors, et cetera. We don't really take a particular view on tech. You know, we're going to own the index. We're going to own everything pretty much globally. So we don't get that excited about it. We worry about it. We're trying to figure out, you know, should we essentially hedge the fangs? Ultimately decided that it doesn't make sense for us right now. It's not cost effective. But we worry about it. But I don't think we buy into the hype because we're not stock pickers.
Can I say
the fangs, for all of you who don't watch financial television, or Facebook, Amazon, Netflix, and Google.
But let me, what Joe said is exactly right. When investors invest in Amazon and Google and Facebook, they don't expect a constant stream of annual returns. Yeah. It's when a company's been around for a long time and the analysts all expect something. When you change that expectation, that hits the price right away. And so there's different kind of investors. There's also traders and long-term holders. You know, there's different types of people in different types of stocks. And that matters a lot in many ways. The real issue I see, though, if a CEO, they have strategic assets. Indra does, Carlos does. They know what's going to make their company great. They know where they have to invest. The question is, how do they convince Teresa and the asset owners that they're investing in the right place? And at the same time, in the short term, they can go up or down based on volatility, based on analyst expectations or guidance or things like that. The problem is, I'm going to come back to what Carlos said and I said originally, there's no way to measure what they're telling us is exactly right. Like, there isn't quarterly earnings. And so you have to really explain your long-term strategy, and you have to come up with some way for agreement between asset owners and managers and corporates to measure that and compare it to quarterly earnings. Otherwise, there's only one thing to fall back on, and that's the short term.
But, Mark, let me ask you a question.
Yeah.
Let's say that CEOs are willing to spend the time to educate investors on the strategy. You think investors... I'm just asking the question, Teresa, not an opinion. Are they really able to understand what companies are saying? That's the first question.
I raised this morning in the discussion. I basically think there's a big disconnect between investors and value creators. Mm. So we extract value from the market. You create value and contribute it to the market. And I think that's a really fundamental a difference in view and expertise. And so I've been quite skeptical of the investment community's ability to really discern what is going to create value, what's going to create corporate value over time. And I think part of it is we're giving the wrong kind of education. The CFA Institute is all focused on pure financial metrics. I think there needs to be a lot more business education of analysts to understand that. So I kind of look at, if you think about engagement between investors and corporations, I think we're in very early days, and I think the whole engagement process and the people who are doing that has to change.
I think finance and accounting has trumped strategy excessively.
Totally.
The whole world is ratio-driven, mm-hmm. comparison-driven, and accounting-driven, even though the accounting rules are not clear across companies. Well,
we know they don't reflect value, long-term value.
And so what happens is they just look at the numbers and say, yep. Well, this person's GNA is 8 and yours is 10, therefore you've got 2 points to cut. Not thinking about two different models of the company because you got to spend to get efficiency. Nobody thinks about the strategic consequences. They blindly look at the numbers, and a bunch of number crunchers put out a little spreadsheet, and that to them is strategy.
But can I just say just one thing?
Sorry.
We need to defend investors here.
I want to beat this dead horse before we go to Joe. Which is the reason they do that, it's because it's still the only thing they have that the regulators agree to that you can compare cost companies. There's nothing else they can look to other than what CEOs say. Yep. And so that's why it exists, and I think we need something else. Go ahead.
I want to pick up a point that actually relates what Teresa said in the beginning and what you said, which is some of the legal framework actually constrains what the pension funds and others do because they have a fiduciary responsibility. And the question is how you interpret that. I think the way that it has been interpreted is wrong. So right now, as a fiduciary responsibility, it often means maximizing short-term value because that's the only thing they can easily see. But there are other things that we know are going to happen. For instance, we know that climate change is going to happen. We know that there's going to be a carbon price and that assets, companies that have large carbon assets, the value is going to go down. So I think there's a huge climate risk for anybody that's investing in a fossil fuel company. And so I think it's a violation of their fiduciary responsibility to focus on short-term returns if you buy a fossil stock and not think about the climate change. And the same thing, moving into electric was very important for you because you would have been a fossil company because if you hadn't done that. And now you're, leading part of the way for electric cars. And so as we think about the future, I think that there are many areas where if you look at what civil society does, if you look at where, the concerns that we as a community have, they are anticipating where the regulatory environment is going to be in the future. And to ignore that signal, I think, is a violation of fiduciary responsibility and poor investment.
Well, and the way we reconcile it, I mean, basically, if you think of our in-statute mandate is to maximize return at a prudent level of risk. Mm-hmm. And as you move your time horizon out, you start accounting for risks that you would not account for in the short term. So climate is something we actually adopted an investment belief saying not all risks are known at the time, but it's our obligation as a fiduciary to try and understand evolving risks. And there's a lot of talk about fossil fuels being a potentially stranded asset. Well, the history of investing is the history of good investing is the history of understanding what's going to be stranded going forward. So it's not a new concept for an investor. So what we've tried to do to get our portfolio managers comfortable with this is always put it through a risk lens. What are the risks that are going to really impact our portfolio, 5 years, 10 years from now? And then that aligns fiduciary duty, with societal good over time.
So let me note 2 points that I think have come out that is something I've seen over my career as well. Is I think Indra, you made it very clear that there different investors are different. And some are the incredibly boring, statutory ones that you described, but there are those who are actually interested in long-term strategy, the ones who invest early in Silicon Valley companies, they'll take that. Some investors will hate it if you do what Netflix did last night. Obviously, others will like it. So as a management team, you need to find the investors that are in sync with your strategy, cultivate relationships with them, and then ultimately let everybody else take their course. And the second piece, and I think you all share this, because you've been in your jobs, Mark, you will have a long tenure, short tenure, relatively short tenure thus far, but Carlos and Indra, you've been in your jobs for a long time. Average tenure of a CEO now is very short because boards are very impatient because stock prices don't go up, they get hammered, replace the CEO, maybe they'll immediately cut a country and EBITDA will go up or what have you. But you have obviously won the support of your boards and your shareholders, despite the fact that your stocks weren't skyrocketing in that period. So I think trust in that person actually may be more important than the age of the company. Because yeah, I don't know
if it's a question of trust or a question of credit. You're being given credit for the past performance. Because you're being given credit for the past performance, you can allow yourself to go a little bit further. I mean, every day we see in our industry, in many industry, CEOs fired because, you know, the share didn't move for the last year, or things which are pretty short term. I think the letter that Larry Fink signed and distributing is going to obviously have to induce a lot of change, not only in the way companies talk about their long-term plan, but particularly on the financial community, which is analyzing the performance of the company, because today you have the perfect theoretical approach. But when we face the analysts, it's a completely different ball game. It's a different ball game. So there is a complete disconnect between the theoretical approach, which is a little bit, idealistic, and the reality where you're scared to miss your quarter because a lot of things that you're doing on the long term can be totally handicapped by the fact that you missed it. And you're talking about I think the short tenure of CEOs is a real problem. It's a real problem. Contrary to Professor Stiglitz, the car industry is concentrated innovation today. That's why, everybody wants to be in the car industry or everybody's moving to the car industry. That means everybody wants to make the automated car, the autonomous car, the robo-taxi. Google is involved in it, Uber want to be there. That means a lot of these companies are there. And why? Because they consider that the most secure growth happening in the next years is the number of miles traveled on the planet. They estimate that we're going to move from 1.5 trillion miles traveled today to more than 3.5 to 4 trillion miles. That's what they see. And they say the only sector where we can have a return on investments made on artificial intelligence, it's about mobility and it's about transportation. It has been said very clearly to me by the CEO of NVIDIA, which is one of the tech company which is blooming. They said, you guys are for us the best bet on return, because we know that if we contribute to the car without a driver, we're going to have a huge return on our technology. That's the situation we are facing. So short-term tenure of CEOs, totally in contradiction with everything we need to implement in terms of technology, that takes a lot of time. Autonomous car is 7-8 years. Connected cars is 3-4 years. Electric cars is 7-8 years. And the average tenure of a CEO in the United States, I understand, is about 4 years.
A little bit longer.
Huh?
A little bit longer.
Six, a little bit longer, about 5 years?
Six.
But even 6 years, it's not enough. Because if every time you have a revolution, you need on average 7-8-9 years, you have a problem.
I think, Henry, in my case, in our case, in PepsiCo's case, and I've been CEO in my 12th year, so I feel like one of the ancient ones around. 12 years ago, when I took over the company, we articulated our strategy. But articulated it based on mega trends that we saw happening in this marketplace. So every time we talk to investors, we talked about the mega trends and therefore the strategy. And basically told the investor, if you don't buy into the strategy, don't question the strategy, question the mega trends, because the strategy is a fallout of the trends. And the funny thing is, the reason the investors didn't ask for my head and my board supported me is because they looked at the mega trends and said, those mega trends are the right ones. So how can we question the strategy if it just results from the mega trends? And the other thing, too, is I own a lot of PepsiCo stock personally, so I bet my complete wealth on our company because I felt this company, if it followed the strategy, would be in the right place. And so I was my own internal activist, and I was telling my investors, if you have a better strategy for our company, tell me, we will listen to you. We're not, you know, really stuck on our strategy if you believe you have a better strategy. But if you don't have a better one, our strategy holds. The good news is, being in food and beverage, each one could relate to our products. So when you talk about health and wellness and they say, why do you have to do healthy products? Okay, you know, your job is to sell more soda and chips. And then you look at them and say, have you changed your eating and drinking habits? Oh, absolutely, gave it all up. So why do you think we shouldn't change? You know, immediately silence. Or they'll send you, you know, an apology note 3 years later by way of a sell-side report which says, she was right. Okay, and so, as I said, I have the scars to prove for it, but I had a wonderful board that stuck by us because the mega trends which resulted in the strategy could not be argued with. And I think that's what we've got to do as CEOs. Start with an external perception, view of the world that results in a strategy.
So let me, I'm going to open up to questions in about 5 minutes, but let me come to one very specific topic, which is employee compensation. One of the things in the United States in particular is we have so many tremendously successful, fabulously wealthy global companies that if you look at what they pay rank and file, and this is especially common in the retail industry, you can have professionals who work full-time for these companies who are poor, below the poverty line, which strikes a lot of us as not being right or fair, or at least sharing in the incredible wealth that the company is creating. How do we deal with that? How do you think about it as CEOs? And we, part of this has coincided with the decline of labor unions, who used to be responsible for the well-paid manufacturing jobs that everyone wants to come back, that aren't going to come back because the manufacturing has changed. How do we get those in the retail industry? And how do we encourage more companies to do what Walmart has done recently, to its credit, Apple, Starbucks, many other companies, where they have seemingly voluntarily raised wages, not as high as some people would like, to $15 or $16 an hour, but at least raise them more than they had to. Because if you talk to investors, sometimes they will say, look, every dollar you pay to an employee is a cost. You should cut those costs as much as possible, pay as little as possible, which is obviously not in the same spirit.
Well, you know, we cannot talk about, I mean, I can't talk about the service industry, but I can talk about the car industry because we are big employers. You know, we employ 450,000 people directly. Plus, if you count the people distributing our car, the suppliers working for us, we're talking about 2.5 to 3 million people. For us, the obviously the salary is a cost, but also is a very important ingredient for sustainability. It's a very important ingredient. And so if you look only at the short term, you're going to go to the extreme by saying, you know, every salary is a cost. But if, as we said, CEOs have to look at the long term and the sustainability of the business, they need to ponder that with, I need to make my workforce, you know, engaged. I need my workforce to stay. I need stability. And that's the other side. You can't ignore that. You cannot ignore both, that you are in a very competitive industry, but at the same time, you need the sustainability of your business. That's the way we look at it.
Yeah, I agree very strongly with Carlos. And there's a whole theory of economics called the efficiency wage theory that points out the higher wages that elicit more productive. Henry Ford in the car industry started that with a $5 a day salary, and it worked for Ford. The gestures, what I see is some of the gestures that are being made by Walmart are just that, gestures. I mean, they're raising wages when they know that the minimum wage is going to go up. And so they're trying to claim credit as doing something voluntary, knowing that it's going to be forced on them very shortly. Part of this is a sales trick for the tax cut that disproportionately went to the very wealthy. And so he's trying to tell ordinary people that you're getting a little slice of that tax cut. You're getting it once, and we're going to go back to this low-wage policy. And it's not only wages, it's working conditions. One of the criticisms in the retail sector is the way that they, you don't know a week in advance what your work week is going to be. And there are studies about what that does to individuals to have not to be able to know when they're going to work the next week. So it's a whole set of policies that take advantage of the fact that in today's labor market, workers don't have any power. And that comes from the evisceration of unions, from globalization, where you're putting American workers in competition with low-wage workers in other countries. A whole set of forces have been at play that have had the effect of weakening workers' bargaining power. And I think that has a very negative effect on productivity over the long run.
Now, I would think, Teresa, if Walmart came to you and said, look, we're raising our wage from $9 an hour to $11 an hour, that's what they just did. What if they came in and said, we're going to raise it to $15 an hour? We just think it's the right thing to do for all the people that work for us. And by the way, a lot of those people shop at Walmart. It should accelerate our top line. How would you react to that?
Well, again, we're an indexer, so we're going to own them no matter what.
If you were an activist, how would you?
The Pacific Northwest, where I come from, has a tradition of aligning values with good economic value. And there's two really good examples, Starbucks and Costco. Both of them made commitments to their workforce that even part-time employees would have full health benefits. They have, you know, very decent wages, and they have performed phenomenally. So again, I think, you know, anything that is looking at short-term profits at the expense of anything, whether it be employees, whether it be the environment, et cetera, at some point you're going to pay for that, and Walmart is paying for it. They've had to react to societal forces, and look at, too, their stock price took a beating. Their earnings dropped, and so they had to make adjustments. And so I still think this gets back to time horizon, and you can incorporate values if you're looking at a long time horizon, and that will pay back in the stock price over time.
And just to touch on unions again, do you feel that we need unions, Professor Stieglitz and Indra? Do you think that is the answer? Or can companies do this on their own?
Well, I think that there may be some companies that will do it on their own. But as I look across the landscape in the United States, it hasn't happened. And that's why you see the kind of exploitation that Walmart has been engaged in. And it's exploiting, in that sense, not only workers, but it's also exploiting, you know, might say, the public sector, because everybody else is paying for the healthcare cost that Walmart shifted on to the public sector. So I think that it's all important for workers in one way or another to have voice. And there are different ways of doing it. But I think as I see the American landscape, unions are an important part of that.
I think from our perspective, we look at our employees, especially our frontline workers, as the assets that drive our business as opposed to tools of the trade. The minute you think of them as assets that drive the business, you give them a good wage, you give them medical benefits, you give them pension benefits, and you give them all of the accoutrement that go with any management person. So we treat our people quite well. We'd like to do even better, but we treat them well. And as long as we continue to do that, even if we have some unions in part of the country, I think we can have a constructive dialogue with them. If we violate that pact we have with our frontline, I think it will have consequences for us.
I'm just going to take what probably won't be a popular position, I guess, after hearing these comments, but I think businesses invest a lot in their people that they don't get credit for as well. I mean, we have 2 million people apply every last year to work at EY. We hired 3%, 65,000 people. Why do people want to come work for us? We have higher wages. We're not minimum wage firm. Obviously, we're professional services. But it's our training and giving them skills to succeed. When you get out of college anymore, your job that you're going to work for doesn't exist today. The technology you're going to use isn't around. And the problem you're going to solve hasn't been identified yet. And if you're not investing in them and their, you know, and you're seeing more and more investment by businesses across the board. Most healthcare and benefits are paid for by employers. And a lot of companies' wages are going up, not because, like you said, I don't think the tax bill, but I think when a company gets lower taxes, they can only do three things with the money. They either pay their employees more, they either invest in capital equipment to increase productivity, or they pay their shareholders in either buybacks or dividends. And that's all they can do. They can't buy a lunch. They can't go on vacation. They're going to do some things with that money, and how they allocate it we'll see over the next year or so.
Great. Let's take some of your questions right there.
Thank you. I have a question, especially there seems to be some consensus about that quarterly results are a bad measure for companies, for productivity. Yet at an aggregate level, at societal level, we still use quite a similar measure, namely GDP. I'm very curious about your take, and especially Professor Stiglitz's and Mrs. Noye's take on GDP.
Good question.
Well, I chaired a commission that was appointed by President Sarkozy that looked at this issue, and we wrote a report called, you know, Mismeasuring Our Lives, Why GDP Doesn't Add Up. And the consensus of this commission was that GDP was not a good, certainly not a good measure of well-being, and that there are systematic biases that lead us to make wrong policies. And, you know, it's like we've been talking here at the corporate level, what you measure affects what you do. If you're measuring short term, you're going to behave short term. Very hard to be long term. Same thing for our society. If we're measuring GDP and we don't think about environmental degradation, resource depletion, inequality, what's happening to health status of our citizens, all of these other things, then we won't be doing the kinds of things that we ought to be doing for the long-run prosperity and well-being of our country.
I don't think anybody ever said quarterly earnings is bad. Quarterly earnings alone is not enough. I think it's got to be a judicious balance. And what you look at on a quarterly basis and what you look at on a long-term basis is equally important. Judging a company completely by quarterly performance is a bad way to look at a company. Let me tell you the difference. In a company, if a quarterly performance missed not the company's plans and a sell-side analyst's consensus, the sell-side analysts who don't run the company, they put out a consensus. If you miss that, they sell your stock and the price goes down. If GDP comes in lower, nobody leaves the country as a consequence. So very different macro and micro basis. So I think GDP is sort of a scorecard on a run, on a rolling basis to understand how the economy is doing. We can talk about the GDP measure itself that I leave to Professor Stiglitz. But from a quarterly earnings perspective, I think what we really have to talk about, Mark, is what should you report on a quarterly basis? What should you report on a longer term basis? And how do you educate the investor to look at both? I think there's value to both. It's how do you balance the two?
Great.
Thank you. My name's John Neal. I'm Chairman and Chief Executive of the Unipart Group. So like Carlos, I've been a CEO for quite a long time. The thing that puzzles me as a long-term supporter of free enterprise and capitalism as the best way we know of improving a nation's quality of life is that people don't believe it anymore. In our country, there's a real swing away because people don't see it improving their quality of life. Their wages are stagnant, productivity stagnant. So if we're going to ensure that capitalism continues to win the battle, what are the key three arguments that we would put to convince people that it is still the best way?
Yeah, I think that went to your second point that we really didn't cover as much. It's not only what you report as a corporation, but who do the returns go to? And do you focus, as you talked about, Milton Friedman, is it just shareholders or all stakeholders? And I think you couldn't be more right. I think the license for all of us to lead going forward is in question. And we saw that, you know, whether it's the Brexit vote or Donald Trump winning or whatever. And even where in Germany and Austria and France last year, the traditional parties ended up winning, the increase in nationalistic tendencies and votes in the Congress has gone way up. So this is one of the biggest issues for Davos this year, in my view. We can be really happy that we're growing faster than we ever did. But all of a sudden, all the problems we talked about last year didn't go away. They didn't just disappear. So this goes to the income inequality. And if the GDP grows and it's all in the top 1%, the other 99% don't feel it, right? So I really think it comes to stakeholder evaluation. You know, there's some, Mark Benioff talks about it a lot. Indra talks about it a lot. Carlos has talked about it. There's a lot of CEOs who get that. Talk about the return to your stakeholders, including your communities, your workers, your supply chains, and Paul Polman. Share, you know, he look and will fire supply chains that don't have the values of Unilever. So I think that, you know, we need to be held to those standards. Otherwise, our license to lead will be gone.
Anyone else want to?
I think it's just worth commenting on that that the value corporations create that gives me returns is return to society. So if you think about retirement assets, not just defined benefit or public plan assets, but 401ks, any kind of retirement asset that gets invested, it is ultimately returning to the population. The big problem is so many people do not have access to any kind of retirement. And so from that standpoint, we've got to fix that. But bottom line, when you guys make money, I can pay my beneficiaries. We don't want to forget that.
Can I say, every company in the country could behave responsibly, and yet, just because of the way that the forces of demand and supply are working, wages might not be doing very well. And so when you see, what's happening in the United States, where the full-time income, the income of a full-time male worker is at the same level adjusted for inflation as it was 42 years ago, it's partly because some corporations have not, some companies have not behaved well, but it's also partly because of underlying economic forces, the way the rules of the game have been played, the role of the tax system in not redistributing income, lack of enforcement of antitrust policy, a whole set of things. And in the end, public policy is going to have to play a critical role. I think having responsible corporations is very important to get confidence in business, but that's not sufficient.
My question was precisely to build on Professor Stiglitz's point. We started with a premise that we needed businesses to act because governments weren't, but it seems to me we've been talking about towards better companies, not towards better capitalism. To get better capitalism, do you not need those rules? If you're a company that is selling drinks that have more sugar than is healthy in a human diet in one day, laced with a semi-addictive drug like caffeine, it's not a good idea to sell that to six-year-olds. But you can't stop doing that, because your competitor will do it if you don't. You need the rules that say this has to stop. If you can go and chop down a forest and create more burgers for an obese population, you've got to carry on doing that. Shouldn't companies, in addition to reforming their own policies, also be using their lobbying might to create the bottom line regulation to prevent their competitors from moving into the unethical space that they dearly want to get away from?
So I would, can I just say it before you, because I want to give you time to think about it. Take a breath. I believe it's a dangerous, slippery slope to start to say that everybody that has a point of view on what should or shouldn't be done should be lobbying the governments to tell them what they should or shouldn't do. So that's, again, how you look at this depends on where you probably are on the spectrum of how big government should be and how controlling and how much individuals should have their own choice. But once you decide that you want government to make the decisions of what we can and cannot buy, where and how, and everything else, it becomes a very slippery slope, in my view. Anyway,
thank you, Mark. But I think it's a great question. You know, it's a bit inflammatory, but it's a great question. I think what you're getting to is, what is the soul of the company? What does the company really believe its business model is? Is it an ethical business model for the societies? Okay. When you sold products 50 years ago, that was fine for a society that was active. As society became more sedentary and all kinds of other lifestyle issues cropped up, should you change the portfolio? Yes, absolutely, and companies are doing it. But you've got to feel it inside you that you want to change the portfolio as a way to make money, that you've got to do things right in terms of water usage, carbon footprint, in order to make money. Typically, what's happened is companies focus on making money during the day, and they give money to a social cause in the evening, and they say, this is corporate social responsibility. To me, that is confession, going to confession. I think what we ought to think about is, how do we make money differently? How do you change the fundamental business model? So unless you make money the right way, transforming your portfolio, being environmentally sustainable, treating your people right, unless you do that, you can't drive performance. That's what we've been trying to do. And as I said, scars on my back based on the first 6 years of my CEOship. Kudos for the last 6 years of my CEOship. And so it takes a while. If you've got a strong board, if you're willing to go out there and take, you know, what it takes to, and do what it takes to get your message across, there is hope. Will your competitors challenge you at every point in time? In my industry, they do. Where I said, lower the sugar levels, go to a different product portfolio, they double down on sugar drinks. So what do? You lose share. You give up some share. That's okay, because we played a different portfolio game. But educating the investors was difficult. It requires enormous courage, conviction, consistency. Painful. Very painful.
Professor Stiglitz.
Yeah, there are some areas where I think there is a broad consensus about what the right policies ought to be. I mean, for instance, in climate change, water, you know, those are things that we all know, and it's not a question of, I mean, I it's still opinion, but it's 99.99 against 0.01. So to me, I think there is a corporate responsibility for standing up. Some people at Davos have been very active in trying to have corporations work against corruption. And that's an area where if one company is corrupt, it really puts a burden on others. In the area of mining, if one company can come in and mine in an environmentally destructive way, it puts the other companies at a disadvantage. And it's really important, and I've seen good mining companies do this, go in, lobby the government to say, we want tight environmental regulation so that we can compete on an even playing field. We can do well on that, but we know that there are dirty, mostly private companies, not public, publicly listed, that will come in and take advantage. The final point, I guess, is there are some cases where the public policy is already trying to create the right environment. So climate change is one. Mayor Bloomberg made a big effort in New York City to, you know, childhood obesity is a real problem. And unfortunately, some people in the industry lobbied strongly against it, and it got taken away. And there will be more obese children and more childhood diabetes is a real problem in the United States.
So we have a couple of minutes left. Let me just ask all of you, if you want to make closing remarks, great to hear from you.
Start at the end, or what do you want
to do? Yeah, Carlos.
What we said is short-term financial results are important, but they are insignificant if they are not complemented by something representing the long-term plan of the company. That I think this is one of the conclusions we reach. The second point is, obviously, I think you were talking about regulation and the role of government. Role of government is very important because there are some areas where you don't know how much is too much and how much is not enough. For example, the emissions. You know, how much CO2 are you allowed to have in a car? How much? I mean, is it 20 gram, 50 gram, 100 gram, 120? You're going to have debates, infinite debate, by different parts of society. At a certain point in time, government have to decide these are the rules, and these are the way they're going to change for the next year. So I think the role of government is important, particularly when you cannot make a decision. I mean, if you leave it to the market forces, it's impossible to reach a decision. Obviously, this doesn't mean that you want government in many areas, because I agree with what has been said, that then, you know, if they authorize what can be done or what cannot be done, you're going too far. But I think the role of government is important, and a lot of the technology we are developing, electric car, autonomous car, robot taxi, mobility services, cannot happen by industry alone. We cannot. We need a private-public partnership, because we need infrastructures, we need regulation, we need into what condition you can allow a car to drive on the street without a driver, what are the conditions, cybersecurity, what is the level of cybersecurity you can ensure to make sure that your car is acceptable on the market. We can't decide by ourselves, you know? So that's why I think it's important. This cooperation is important because it allows government to be aware about the evolution of the technology and then make a decision that they that in the present situation, they are the only one to be able to make.
Mark,
so,
quickly.
Since we only have 2 minutes left and four people, I'll be very quick. I think you said it well. I think, and Andrew said it before, I think a CEO's responsibility is to explain the why, not just the what. And then investors can decide if they agree with the why, and governments can decide whether they want to regulate or not the why. But you can't just rely on telling people what you're doing today in the short term. You have to explain why you're doing it for the long term with those megatrends that you talked about.
Andrea, I'll tell you something. I have a plea to the media. If you give companies as much airtime as you give the short-term focused activists to talk about the company, and allow them to finish their statements as opposed to cutting them off mid-statement, I think you'll have a better dialogue. I think you'll have a better dialogue. Today, if you're an activist, you get infinite amount of time on any business show. Companies are never invited. Tell me, when is the last time a company was asked to come in and talk about its strategy in a sensible, complete sentences kind of a way? If that happens, and it's a real discussion, companies and long-term thinking will win. That does not happen to
you. You're invited anytime to visit.
So I want to compliment what you just said by thinking that we need to think about how we change long-term thinking more deeply. So one of the ideas is, for instance, loyalty shares, changing corporate governance to give long-term investors bigger say in the decisions of the firm on the boards, for instance. And that would result in boards that are dominated more by people who are long-term investors. So I think the real point here is I think we need more creativity of how to change our society more towards long-term thinking, which is the only way that we're going to solve the deep problems of our society.
Teresa, last word.
I think that what we've identified today is that there's a new market force, and they're non-financial, and they're societal. And I'm active with Ira Milstein, Columbia University, Milstein Center for Corporate Governance. And Ira, 91-year-old thought leader in governance, a wonderful man. And what he said is we're essentially redefining the future of the American corporation. And I think we need to recognize it's a daunting task, and it's going to come in inches rather than miles, and it's going to be slow and methodic. But we need to understand that we are dealing with a new market force.
Great. On behalf of World Economic Forum and Business Insider, thank you all so much, and thank you for joining.